We're really very fortunate to have with us this evening John Pomfret. He's here to talk about China and especially the U.S.-Chinese relationship going back to the birth of the United States. John's own involvement with China stretches back several decades and has had both a professional and a personal dimension. He covered China for years as a journalist, and he also met his wife there. And their children have been raised in both the United States and China. John first went to China as a student in 1980, one of the first American students to be admitted after Washington formally recognized Beijing. I read this somewhere. I didn't check this with John, but I hope this is true. It's one of those fun facts. The first Chinese nickname that he was given, both of a sign as a sign of his appetite, and I guess maybe to embarrass him, was Rice Bucket. That's true. He's shaking his head. There you go. I had to tell that one. Later in 1988, John returned as a journalist for the Associated Press, but was expelled the next year after the Tiananmen Square protests. 7 years after that, he was back again then as a bureau chief for the Washington Post, and he stayed for a number of years. But he's also spent a number of other years covering wars and other stories elsewhere in the world, including in Europe, Africa, and the Middle East. Here in the U.S., he's served also as Los Angeles bureau chief for the Post and ran the paper's Outlook section for 2 years. And more recently, John was a Fulbright senior scholar in Beijing and recently returned. He's now living on the West Coast after 4 or 5 years in China. In an earlier book published a decade ago entitled Chinese Lessons, John told the story of some of his university classmates in China. His new book, The Beautiful Country and the Middle Kingdom, draws not only on his reporting skills, but on considerable research into the relationship between the United States and China dating back to the mid-18th century. Many of us tend to think that America's ties with China started in 1972 with the visit of President Nixon to China. A visit that, of course, ended the Cold War separation between the two countries. But the United States and China started interacting with and influencing each other long before that, first through trade and then through increasingly complex religious, cultural, military, financial, environmental, and other connections. So why should we care about this history? Well, as John contends in his book, no bilateral relationship in the world today is as significant and will likely have as much impact on the future of our planet. The U.S. and China aren't exactly allies, but they're not enemies either, at least not yet. Theirs is a very complicated relationship, one with past patterns that continue to have a very strong bearing on the present and very likely on what will happen next. So that's why the history that we're about to hear from John this evening is very important. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming John Pomfret.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Bradley. It's great to be here. It's great to be here in Washington, surrounded by so many friends and former colleagues. I spent a lot of wonderful years in Washington. So. On the day that my book is officially out for sale, it's really wonderful to be here in D.C. I wanted to start by just telling you a couple of stories. On a clear morning in May 1865, a Delfield landed in the British colony of Hong Kong after a stormy 149-day voyage on a tea ship out of New York. A friend had squeezed Field, who was suffering from a high fever, into her wedding gown. And there she was, waiting unsteadily on board the ship for her fiancé, a Baptist missionary by the name of Cyrus Chilcott out of New York. The pair had met and gotten engaged in New York and had planned to meet again in Hong Kong, get married in Hong Kong, and then head to Bangkok to preach to Chinese migrants in Bangkok. So a rowboat approaches the ship, but Chilcott's not on board. So the boatman basically tells Field that, sorry, your husband's dead. Oh. He'd been struck down by typhoid fever several months earlier while Field was in the middle of the Pacific Ocean. And there she found herself, as she wrote later, in appalling desolation, alone on the shores of Asia. The ship's captain recommended that she return with him to New York. She set out for Bangkok instead. A farmer's daughter born in 1839 in upstate New York, Field grew up at a time when the social and feminist issues of the late 19th century were rousing a generation. During the Civil War, women had fought slavery, and after the Civil War, they demanded opportunities. Women's colleges opened, and by the time Field was 25 herself, she was the principal of a girls' school in New York. Following her fiancé's death, the Baptist, the Northern Baptist in this case, hired Field as a missionary. So she became one of the first single women to work as a missionary in Asia. Because of Field and pioneers like her, the American missionary endeavor in Asia and also in China became a profoundly feminine one. Women, especially single women, would soon make up the largest share of American missionaries overseas. After clashing with one conservative Baptist minister, who unsuccessfully had her tried for blasphemy because she danced with single men and liked to play cards, he didn't actually know that she also smoked an occasional bowl of hashish, but that's beside the point. Field soon moved from Bangkok to China to join a Baptist mission in Shantou, Swatow, along China's southern coast. Within a year, Field started a school, the Path of Brightness, which constituted the first formal literacy program for women in modern Chinese history. She called her students Bible women. Field soon broadened the curriculum to include hygiene, childcare, basic medical skills, and geography, so that her missionary work began to resemble less an evangelical enterprise than an early version of the Peace Corps. Returning to the United States on vacation in the 1870s and 1880s, Field was a huge hit in churches nationwide. She authored a book on the habits of Chinese women, and she became one of the first women to take actually a medical degree at the University of Pennsylvania's medical school. But over time, Field's heart sort of moving on. The ideas of Charles Darwin and the principles of modern science began to trump Baptist doctrine in her heart. And she concluded that America needed her more than China did. So in 1889, after about two decades in China, Field left missionary work, and she became a nationally renowned science researcher in the United States, a specialist on the evolution of ants, and a leading proponent of the theory of evolution. In addition, she was also a suffragette. She died in 1916 in Seattle. To Field and other partners and other pioneers like her, China actually offered a peculiar and particular form of freedom, an opportunity, at a time when American women could receive an education but had very limited career opportunities at home. For single American women, being a missionary in China was a career and a calling. It was a great career, guaranteeing them a life of excitement and challenges, but of course hardship. In China, American women missionaries served as surgeons when in the United States they were effectively banned from operating rooms. In China, they chaired university departments when in the United States, very few of them could actually teach at the college level. These women set in motion a pattern whereby American women would find freedom and a chance in China far from their home in the United States. So we flash forward to 1995, and you ask the question, where did Hillary Clinton regain her political momentum after a rough few years as the First Lady? From my perspective, it's not a coincidence at all that it was in Beijing at the UN International Women's Conference, where her argument that women's rights are human rights inspired a generation of Chinese women, but also women around the world. Field and her American sisters also had a huge influence on Chinese women that has generally gone unchronicled both in the United States and China. They were key to the single most important human rights advance in China's modern history, which is the unbinding of women's feet, freeing Chinese women literally to move up in the world. They also campaigned against female infanticide. American missionaries put baskets on the sides of Chinese lakes with notes, put your babies here, do not throw them into the pond. American women missionaries also took the lead in educating Chinese girls and providing them with role models for a new type of life. Single American missionaries from that perspective occupied sort of this bizarre space in China. because they had come to China to help Chinese women become Christian, find a nice Chinese Christian husband, and settle into a life of sort of Christian domesticity. But many Chinese looked at these American women and actually did what they did, or wanted to do what they did, not what they taught. So the first graduating class of Jinling's Women's University, which was an American-funded university in Nanjing, took a vow never to marry. And of that class, only one woman ended up breaking the vow. Of course, women from other countries vied for influence in China. So there were anarchists from Russia, there were revolutionaries from France, but none could match the American women in their numbers and in defining what it meant to be a new woman on the cusp of a new century. Adele Field's story is an example of the often unchronicled influence that Americans have had on China and vice versa. It's but one of scores of tales that make up this book, The Beautiful Country in the Middle Kingdom, American China, 1776 to the present. When people ask me what my book is about, I say it's about three things. First of all, it's a story. It's a tale full of swashbuckling adventurers, grifters, soldiers of fortune, plotting diplomats, students, laborers, revolutionaries, and zealous converts who together make up the story of the interaction of two countries, two great countries, one that considered itself the apex of the East and the other that considered itself the apex of the West. It's about the patterns of this love-hate relationship that has risen to rapturous enchantment and fallen to the depths of crushing disappointment. And also it's about, as we've seen with Adele Fields, the deep but really often unacknowledged impact that each people and each nation has had on the other. One of the arguments that I make in the book is that the U.S.-China relationship seems caught in this Buddhist cycle, sort of a Buddhist cycle of reincarnation, with enchantment following disappointment with the turn of history's wheel. There are a lot of echoes in our history. So take the battle against infanticide. In the 1880s, as I just noted, it consisted of putting baskets by waterways and running orphanages. In the 1990s, it returns with the boom in adopted girl babies from China. From 1991 until today, Americans have adopted 80,000 Chinese babies. Almost all of them are girls. In the late 19th century, we had white Californians railing against Chinese labor for taking white men's jobs. Does that sound familiar to anyone? At the same time, we also had Americans working hard to educate more and more Chinese. Some Americans back in the 19th century maintained that if we were patient with China and supported its reforms, that it would, with time, transform itself into a nation much like the United States. Very similar to the arguments that were made in the 70s, 80s, and even in the 90s in the United States about China's future. At the same time, other Americans responded to those dreams, calling them mere hallucinations. Sounds very similar to today as well. The contradictory way in which we approach China, threat, opportunity, we're fearful, we're benevolent, are hardwired in America's DNA. In that way, from my perspective, Donald Trump is no outlier. On the campaign trail, with his accusations that China was raping the United States over trade, you could hear the shouts of the California Workingmen's Party, which rose to prominence in the 1880s on a platform that attacked both California's elites, its oligarchs, and also Chinese immigrants. But also in Trump's let's make a deal bravado, his downplaying of human rights, and his flirtation with the idea of getting rid of America's alliances with South Korea and with Japan, and ceding the Western Pacific to China, you can hear other echoes from the 19th century too. Now, if the Chinese are conflicted about and how we deal with them, if we are conflicted in how we deal with China, the Chinese are also conflicted with how they deal with us. And again, the echoes from the past run fast and furious. In the 1870s, the Qing dynasty, the Qing court, embraced this controversial plan to send Chinese boys, literally like 8-year-old, 9-year-old, 10-year-old, 11-year-olds, to America by themselves to study. The boys went to Hartford under the care of a Yale University graduate by the name of Yung Wing. There they boarded with American families and learned English and excelled at sports and at school. The idea proposed by Yung Wing and embraced by Chinese reformers at the time was that these boys and hundreds of others of like them would bring back to China the secrets of Western science and military techniques to help the Qing court fight off imperialists from Europe and later Japan. But from the start, the Chinese educational mission, as it was called, ran into trouble. The Qing court sent minders to ensure that the boys also received an education in the Confucian classics. When these boys began, clearly because of social pressure, they wanted to be like everybody else, they began shedding their Confucian robes and wearing jackets and ties, these minders protested. When the boys tried to shave off their queues, their pigtails, these minders threatened to send them home. And when a few of these boys began going to church with their American host families, the minders basically appealed to the emperor to shut the program down, and ultimately the program was shut down. In 1881, the New York Times bemoaned the end of this mission and responded that China cannot borrow our learning or science, our material forms of industry, without importing with them the virus of political rebellion. Flash forward to today, and we see the Communist Party struggling with the same issues: how to use Western technology to modernize China without importing the virus of political rebellion. To do it, China once again is moving to block American influence. So in 2015, China's education minister called for a ban on textbooks promoting Western values in all of China's schools. The government has called for artists and architects to serve socialism, which means to fight American influence. It's clamped down on video streaming sites that carry lots of American content, and even ordered the renaming of housing developments that carry pro-Western names, like Yosemite or Manhattan Golden Dream Village. Like the Confucian official class of yesteryear, the Communist Party is instead seeking to inculcate young Chinese with its own values. And like the Confucian minders of yesteryear, President Xi Jinping seeks to include students abroad, including the 250,000 Chinese students in America, in what he calls this patriotic energy. Still, from my perspective, and something that I've seen throughout my life, it's like a bad gene in China's DNA. This China's pro-American tendencies continue to resurface, tormenting China's Communist Party overlords. So as you see, the focus on the patterns of the past is important, and a very important part of the book. But The Beautiful Country is also an exercise, an attempt to do some myth busting, to construct, if you will, a new scaffolding of understanding of our common story, a story that has been too often either politicized or just simply forgotten. So perhaps American missionaries, as some scholars have written, were guilty of cultural imperialism, whatever that means, attempting to shove a love of Jesus down an unwilling craw of the Chinese. But as I detail in my book, they also brought Western medicine, science, and education to China, vastly improving the lives of ordinary Chinese. From the Communist perspective, it is Communist Party doctrine that the United States is out to contain China. But I also show in The Beautiful Country that no other nation has been more important to China's rise than the United States. Your open wallets, our open society, and the open universities of America have been key to China's rise. Another thing I try to accomplish in the book is to bridge the gap between the story of Chinese in America and the story of America in China, because the success of Chinese in America has had a huge influence on creating a positive image of America in the minds of many Chinese. And the story of the Chinese in America is full of lots of surprises. We all know that Chinese laborers built half the transcontinental railroad, but fewer of us know that Chinese capital funneled through Boston investment banks helped fund the Industrial Revolution in the early 1800s. So our Secretary of State, John Forbes Kerry, he is a Forbes. He is a direct descendant of a fellow by the name of John Forbes, who was an investment banker who made his millions in Guangzhou, in Canton, in the early Chinese trade. When he returned to the United States, he brought with him not only his silver, but also the silver of many of his Chinese colleagues. And that money first went into building American railroads from the East Coast to Chicago. So the first time the Chinese were involved in the building of railroads in the United States was not as laborers, but as capitalists. We know also that Chinese were subject to a raft of racist ordinances and a law that actually even banned Chinese laborers from coming to the United States. That's generally known. But few of us know that the Chinese battled those ordinances in court cases around the country, and that Supreme Court decisions made on Chinese cases in the 1880s and the 1890s lay the judicial groundwork for the dismantling of the separate but equal system for African American children in the 1950s. In addition, the Supreme Court case that confirmed U.S. citizenship on someone born in the United States was brought by a Chinese. The surprises keep coming. The present day, many Chinese Americans have a troubled relationship with the identity politics of the left. Many oppose affirmative action, even though they were great beneficiaries of affirmative action. A group of mostly Chinese families has taken Harvard University to court, alleging that Harvard and other leading universities actually have a higher set of standards for Asian applicants than they do for others. Many first-generation Chinese actually voted for Donald Trump, swayed by his tough guy authoritarian vibe and his attacks on political correctness. Like I said, this is a deeply tangled relationship. In closing, I've been asked, who is this book for? And really, as Brad said, it's for anyone who's interested in the most consequential relationship between any two countries in the world. It's for people who like big histories and, you know, when it's a little bit of a big history. But it's also for businessmen and businesswomen, academics, policymakers, but most important, the general reader. Because China is part of our life, whether we like it or not. It is part of your life, and it's only going to get more important. Friends have asked me why I devoted 6 years of my life to this project. And my response was, first of all, only someone as knuckleheaded as a recovering reporter could have thought up the idea. But secondly, as Brad had noted, my personal history drove me to the project. As Brad noted, I first went to China in 1980, part of the second group of Americans to study in China. I slept on a bed that I'm 6'3", my bed was 5'10". I slept on that bed for a year and a half. China became part of me whether I liked it or not. I became a reporter, as Brad noted. I was tossed out of China. I met my wife in China. Over the past 4 decades, I've lived in China for about 20 years. So in these ways, I'm a product of this interaction between the beautiful country, which that's what the Chinese call the United States, Meiguo, and the Middle Kingdom, which is what we call China, Zhongguo. And that brings me to the third part that my book is about, an attempt to show, if you will, a way forward, especially in these perilous times, suggesting that if the Chinese would study a little bit more about us and we learn a little bit more about them, perhaps the relationship could be nudged onto a more stable ground. So thank you very much, and I look forward to your questions. And there are microphones here.
Thank you for your book and your interesting talk. So I'm one of those people that went to China to adopt a girl in 1995. What can you tell me about how Chinese feel about those adoptions and the status of women? I understand there's a shortage of available women. It's causing social tensions.
Yeah. So if you look at population statistics, there's a cultural preference for women, cultural preference for having boys, partially because of inheritance issues, and that generally speaking, when a woman marries, she leaves the family, and so she's no longer responsible for her parents. And so, specifically in the countryside, where a family has to rely on the son's family to take care of them in their dotage. China doesn't have a social security system yet. It's trying to build one, but that's sort of the financial push that causes them to be prejudiced against women, in addition to the cultural issues as well. So in some provinces, you have very skewed gender balances. Like in some of the southwestern provinces, like Guangxi, for example, you have of women, you have sort of 137 males for 100 women. Those statistics, there's the general estimate among Chinese demographers that there's a potentially unmarriageable group of men about 40 million. And that could create long-term social tensions because unmarried guys have a tendency to be a little bit more difficult to deal with than married men. So there is that. That said, about the adoptions, the government has actually taken steps to restrict and make it more difficult for people to adopt Chinese kids, increasing the age limit, and also they have some difficulties with sort of same-sex marriages as well. But that said, generally among the Chinese, it's viewed with sort of how it's viewed in the United States as a very positive thing of taking somebody who was living in an orphanage and giving them a better life. And so I think generally speaking, a lot of Chinese have a very positive view of that. The governmental view, I think, is more tortured because there was a lot of corruption involved and a lot of people making a lot of money. But generally speaking, in the society, there's an acceptance of these type of what they would view it as a charitable act.
I guess I'm next. I'm just fishing for a possible good story here. You mentioned that you were, I think you said, tossed out of China after Tiananmen Square. Why you? Was it anything like anything? Sort of a random pick, or was it based on stories you had written and so forth?
So there were two resident correspondents who were expelled, a VOA reporter, and I was with the AP. And from the Chinese perspective, I mean, VOA is a governmental organization. And the AP from the Associated Press from the Chinese perspective is also a governmental organization, even though it's not. And so I was the low man on the totem pole of the AP hierarchy. And so generally speaking, my understanding was it was for those reasons. They view this as a way to blame America for the counter-revolutionary rebellion that they had.
Okay, great, thanks.
Sir, you've provided an absolutely fascinating history of China. And along those lines, Graham Allison at the Belfer Center has also suggested that the president have a council of historical advisors and things like that. You know, my question to you is, what, you know, knowing all the stuff that we know and with all the Chinese here in this country, I'm kind of wondering, what is your take on the relevance of knowing all this history and understanding all this history, especially after November 8th?
I think it's of continuing, one, above and beyond its relevance, it's a great story. And we live and die. I mean, I spent my life telling stories. I was a newspaper reporter, and that is at its best telling stories. And so I like telling stories. And for me, this is the best yarn I've ever bumped into. It's not an exclusive because lots of people have told it really well before me, but it's a hell of a tale. And so in and of itself, let's just sort of set the relevance aside, set November 8th aside, there's just a great story to be told about Chinese and Americans together making a common history. But in terms of looking towards the future, yeah, I think there's a lot of relevance of knowing this stuff, because this, if you can help people understand that some of your reactions to China and some of their reactions to us are hardwired from our history, that will allow us in some ways to sort of understand those reactions better and in a way to control some of the emotions about them. I mean, Americans have a very, and you see it in the Obama administration clearly, have a very emotional reaction to China. That China, the bet that they made, that a series of American presidents made on China, that China was going to become more and more like the United States as long as we had a good relationship with China, it didn't work out that way. And there's a lot of emotional response to that in some of Obama's policies and some of the policies of his predecessors as well, of like, you guys have not followed the plan, so therefore we're going to do X, Y, and Z to you. Like, for example, this whole ridiculous attempt to block China's Asia Infrastructure Investment Bank. This is a little bit inside baseball, but the type of that's an emotional response to China. It's not thought out. And if we sort of understand the dangers of our rapturous enchantment, but also the dangers of our crushing disappointment, I think we begin can come to a space where we're less emotionally involved, as they should do as well. I mean, the Chinese invested a lot emotionally in the relationship, specifically in the early years with Nixon and Carter, both of whom told them they were going to get back Taiwan, right? I mean, it's clear if you read the unclassified transcripts, you're getting Taiwan back. But the American people and Congress had different plans in mind, and they stopped that, and the Chinese have not gotten over it ever since. I mean, it's a continuing issue with them of like, where's Taiwan? We want it back. You guys are supposed to, I mean, Carter even told the Chinese he was going to pull U.S. troops out of Korea, which effectively would have ceded the peninsula to China's influence, which is how they believe they should be running the show. So these type of emotional issues, I think, are important, and understanding where they come in history is, I think, pretty important and relevant too, even after November 8th, maybe even more so.
Thank you.
Hey, John.
Hi.
I'm Susan Lawrence.
Hi.
Good to see you. Congratulations.
Hi,
on the book.
Thank you.
It sounds like you've got a fantastic number of personal, quirky tales of all sorts in the book. I wondered if you could talk to us a bit about your sources. Where did you find these tales, both in U.S. and in Chinese sources?
So I wrote the book mostly in China. And one, because my family was living in China, so I better do it in China if I wanted to hang out with my family. But other than that, I got a lot of inspiration from Chinese historians and from Chinese journalists who've put a lot of effort in writing about U.S.-China relations or in researching it, but in not being able to publish it. Or if they can publish stuff, it's often published in obscure, out-of-the-way journals which aren't accessed by American scholars. And so that was, for me, a really important source for my writing. And then in the States, I had access to massive reams of unpublished PhD theses. And I used those, the Library of Congress, the National Archives, the archives of the Baptists in Atlanta. So a lot of missionary archives were also very helpful to me. And so that was very, and also then finally in Taiwan at the archives of the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. So those, and then I had a couple of instances where I could never go to Chinese archives because the rules have changed. In some cases they allow, but now they're increasingly not allowing foreigners to go into their archives. But Chinese would go to the archives on my behalf and pull stuff. So to write about the anti-American campaigns of the 1950s, I had access through friends into archives, specifically about how the campaign was carried out in Shanghai. So. I couldn't do any archival work myself in China, but it wasn't for lack of trying. It's just the rules had changed. Mm-hmm. Maybe they'll change back. So,
can hope. Yeah.
Hi, John.
Hi.
I want to follow up on some of your comments about the need for better intercultural understanding between U.S. and Chinese,
right.
Especially on the part of just everyday people. This is admittedly a little self-serving. I was a Peace Corps volunteer in China from 2011 to 2014 mm-hmm. in Chongqing. And I wanted to ask you if you had many or any run-ins with Peace Corps volunteers or much research into Peace Corps in China and how effective you think that is for intercultural understanding. And if not, what do you think would be the best vehicles for better intercultural understanding moving forward?
I think from my perspective, the Peace Corps, and I had significant contact with an ex-Peace Corps volunteer, Peter Hessler, because we played basketball together a lot.
Yeah.
And he has a great jump shot, I can guarantee you. He's a very good runner, but has a really sweet jump shot. But I think it's a great thing, and I think the more of it, the better. Also, there was an attempt by the United States to open up these American centers, sort of as a parallel to the Chinese Confucian Institutes. But sadly, the Chinese government has blocked the opening of most American centers in China, again, because it's so interested in sort of limiting American influence. So while the Chinese government increases its paranoia, I think it's all the more important for Americans to go engage Chinese. Like I said, inside, this paranoia is this pro-Chinese person sort of screaming to get out. I mean, Xi Jinping may rail against the United States as trying to contain China and do everything in his power to have the Communist Party block American influence, but where does he send his daughter to college? Sends her to Harvard. So at the same time that they're very sort of schizophrenic from that perspective. And so my view of it is the deeper you can engage on these issues, the better it is for everybody. And it does help. And even though you're, as a Peace Corps volunteer, you're only gonna bump into obviously a limited circle of people, but that will influence people nonetheless over time. So that's kind of my view.
Thank you.
More engagement is better. But not engagement where you basically give China everything it wants. I think that view, which was very prevalent in the 70s and the 80s, and even into the 90s, was very detrimental to U.S.-China relations. Because it, in the words of Dick Armitage, who was a former high-level State Department guy, it basically, as he said, it taught the dog to piss on the rug. It rewarded very bad behavior, which was really negative, actually, for U.S.-China relations, because it increased their belief that they were going to get more stuff from us. And at a certain point, we said, the game's over. We can't give you any more. And I think that type of kind of sort of endless giving is very bad for the relationship. And a much more transactional view of this is good for us, it's good for you, great, let's do it, is actually better for the future.
Can I ask you a
Yeah, you don't have to get up. I'll repeat it. Yeah. Ask me. You don't have to go. So the question is, did I spend much time in Hong Kong, and what do I think the future looks like for them? I lived in Hong Kong for 3 years. under the former colonial masters, the British, but I've been to Hong Kong a lot. So I think Hong Kong is a headache for China because it's a hugely important financial entrepot for China, for deal making, et cetera. But at the same time, it's unruly. They can't control it. And so right now, we're in a very low phase for Hong Kong's future, where you have the Chinese meddling in all sorts of things, blocking people who've been elected to LegCo from taking their offices, these type of issues, and perhaps even meddling in the legal system. So I look at Hong Kong, and I think Hong Kong increasingly is going to become less of an international city and much more of a big Chinese city. And at the other side, you have Shanghai waiting to eat Hong Kong's lunch. Shanghai is very competitive with Hong Kong. It doesn't like the fact that, I mean, Shanghai used to be the Paris of the East, and it wants to regain that mantle. And as Hong Kong slips and slides, Shanghai will benefit from that. And of course, if you look at Beijing, who has more influence in Beijing, Hong Kong or Shanghai? Of course, it's Shanghai. So I think ultimately Hong Kong will slide away from, it will return to becoming, to being more a Chinese city and less an international city in the future. Hello? I'll get you in a second.
Question, how worried are you about this whole South China Sea competition?
Yeah, so the question was on the South China Sea competition and how worried am I? If there is a situation where you have what they call a strategic corporal, like some guy on a boat who presses a button he shouldn't press, and there's, you know, like a kinetic incident and there's firing and people die, then I'm worried. But the current dance that's being played right now, I think is a lot of it is kabuki. And as long as the Chinese don't do, like build on the Scarborough Shoal, which would be, to use a much often misused expression, the red line, because once they did that, they would control access to the Manila Bay. And that would not be, despite the fact that the Philippines right now is run by somebody even nuttier than Donald Trump, that would not even be good, not even be good for him. And so one looks at the Scarborough Shoal and think of the Chinese seem to be reluctant to build there. And with their unsurety about Trump, I would think actually they would not be in a position to want to test right now. You think that naturally would be, but I think if there's going to be problems, it will be problems in other areas. I think the South China Sea in the long term is actually, China has won most of it. But if we can stop, if the Americans believe that they can stop them at the Scarborough Shoal, that'll be okay, because at least we can continue to protect something, a nation that remains a treaty ally. Truth in advertising. Sorry. So, I mean, Mao remains a hugely important figure in China. He's a very ambiguous figure. So, if you look at what Xi Jinping is doing, the president, he's taking a lot of tools from the Maoist toolbox. This sort of cult of personality. You see Xi Jinping's face on plates. People are calling him a core leader. So there's a lot of Maoist terminology and Maoist kind of techniques that he's using. But the reality is Xi is much more of sort of a statist or a Stalinist than Mao was. Xi is not unleashing the masses to have some type of new cultural revolution in China who are then going to sort of take their hammer and tongs to the bureaucracy of the Communist Party. Xi is very much a party man. And so while he's using Mao's techniques, he's sort of embracing the ideas of Liu Shaoqi, who was the number two in China that nobody knows. Mao ultimately had him killed. But so Mao remains to be very important. And also Mao's ideas about the United States and about America as both a huge opportunity and a huge threat remain central to the Communist Party ideology. And Mao really came of age. He really took power in China. Yes, he took over China in 1949, no doubt about it. But he became an international communist hero when he fought the United States to a draw in the Korean War. And he used the Korean War in China to concretize and to ensure that his rule would stay. And that view that the Chinese have of America as being a very useful tool to use to control China is something that has remained today. And so that's one of his legacies. This very, but at the same time, he was obsessed with the United States. He saw all the American movies. He always believed that there would be a great revolution in America from the American underclass. It hasn't happened. Well, maybe it just happened. Who knows? But he really believed that this revolution was coming. He was nuts about American movies. And so he illustrates this very schizophrenic response that the Chinese have to the United States as an incredibly attractive place, but also a very dangerous place, too. Gentleman in the back with the red shirt on.
Yeah.
Hey, man.
So you can send back to the Washington Post when we need you. Can you talk a little bit about North Korea? Is there a limit to what China will tolerate in North Korea? And are the Chinese doing anything that you seem to prepare for Donald Trump?
So the question was on North Korea, and is there a limit to what the Chinese will tolerate from North Korea? So I think that from my perspective, North Korea is the Chinese look at the stability of the North Korean state as an issue of existential importance to the regime. This is China's East Germany. And if it falls, they think the Chinese regime could fall next. If you look at it from China's perspective, a lot of people put this stress on, there's going to be all these Korean refugees, it's going to be a hellhole. But actually, the thing that they worry about is the unification, the potential unification of the peninsula under a pro-American government with American troops on the peninsula. They also look at it as a real headache because there are millions and millions of Korean Chinese who occupy a big chunk of what used to be called Manchuria. And the Koreans are nationalists. And once that thing's united, they're going to want to go back to the motherland. And how is the Chinese going to deal with that? So from their perspective, it's got to stay North Korea. And so all this chatter about, well, we'll tell the Chinese that we'll leave South Korea once it's unified and it'll be neutral and everything, that they don't believe it at all. They think it's basically an American plot to lure them into some type of, you know, dream scenario. And so from their view, denuclearization of the peninsula is like maybe issue number 50, but issue 1 through 49 is maintaining North Korea as a buffer state. And that's something that even despite the fact that there's a complete nuthole running North Korea is something that they will basically work as hard as they can to maintain. My perspective is that the outsourcing of U.S. North Korean policy to China for the past 8 years, for the past 12 years, maybe even 16 years, was basically a Washington that could not deal with this problem by itself and believed that China would solve it. But I thought from the start it was just a fantasy because they can't see that place falling apart. In terms of their preparation for Trump, I think you already see them preparing for Trump. You already see China being a lot more statesmanlike, right? You have Xi Jinping making the statements that globalization is not actually that bad after all. You have Xi making the statements that the United States should not leave the global climate deal. And so China's behavior, as we become kind of nuttier, China's behavior will improve. And it's part of the whoop and morph of the relationship, that they might actually achieve some level of maturity if we sort of descend into adolescence. It's kind of the plus side of the difficult relationship. But you already see that happening, so I think there's a lot of preparation. In the back, sorry.
You started your talk talking about missionaries. We are now at the point, this generation of Foreign Service officers is basically the first generation of U.S. Foreign Service officers who did not have a missionary heritage.
Yeah. So I devote a lot of pages to the missionary enterprise in China, and then to the change in the American view towards China, as specifically during the Obama years, where I think it really accelerated and became increasingly negative. But the influence that the missionary, and of course Henry Luce was a missionary son, the influence of the missionary idea, the benevolent belief in helping China, was a powerful influence. And I think it even influenced very much so our rapprochement with China in the 1970s as well, especially with all the, you know, I mean, basically by the early 1960s, most church groups in the United States were arguing for normalization with China. I mean, normalization with China, and many people in this room are old enough to remember, did not happen as a lightning bolt from the sky. From the 1960s on, the United States was preparing for normalization with China, even though, you know, we fought some wars in between, including one in Vietnam. But, I mean, Frank Sinatra, in a Playboy interview in 1962, was like, of course we should recognize the Chinese. It's hard to hide 800 million people under the rug. And if old Blue Eyes was engaged on that level, it shows you that the rest of America was actually beginning to open its mind to that idea as well. So.
Yeah.
I think it's highly likely. And the question was, there's been reports that the Vatican and China have been negotiating, and what is the possibility for a breakthrough? And that would mean relations between the Catholic Church and China would be resumed after a break from 1949 on. And I think it's highly likely. And I think that it's an interesting issue because there's a lot of still very anti-Catholic activity and anti-Christian activity carried out by the Chinese government. Christianity is still an oppressed religion in China. In fact, it's more oppressed now than it was, for example, 10 years ago. Mostly actually Protestant evangelical, Christianity, the Protestant evangelical types, but also Catholics as well. And I think this is part of a calculation on the part of the Vatican that they will benefit more by engaging. It's sort of the old engagement theory of foreign policy, that if you get in the tent, then you will get more benefits for your followers than if you're outside the tent. And I think that's potentially debatable, but there's an argument on its behalf as well. But my guess is that they will have relations sometime soon.
Mm-hmm. They send remittances every year from Italy in five times the average of any immigrant aside from the Philippines.
Yeah.
What is the situation in the United States?
So, his question was, he lives in Italy, and the Italian community in China is the Chinese community in Italy is the third or second largest foreign community? Second largest foreign community, and they send a huge amount of remittances back to China. The Chinese community in the United States also sends a large amount of remittances in China, but generally speaking, the immigrant experience in America is a bit different than it is in Italy, because when people come here and have kids, their kids get Americanized really fast. And not necessarily they break with the home country. Well, that's what happens in the United States. That's one of the big differences, that the Chinese community, and also because Chinese have been coming to the United States for generations, even though, yes, the provincial makeup has really changed. In the beginning, in the 1900s, in the late 1800s, 99.9% of the Chinese came from literally one county outside of Guangzhou. Now, of course, Chinese come from all over China. But the process of acculturation in the United States among Chinese is very rapid. And they almost immediately come in the United States. They excel in schools, so much so that in some sort of school districts, there's almost this kind of anti-Chinese bias. About, oh my God, your kid goes to a Chinese school. I guess he can't compete. That type of sort of stuff you hear in American communities, especially actually even in my neighborhood, you hear that as well. So the acculturation process is much more rapid in the United States, even among first and second generation Chinese. Yeah. Right. So the question is, how wealthy are the Chinese? Many of them come to the United States and pay full tuition. There is an enormous amount of money in China, a lot. And I mean, I used to consider myself relatively well off compared to the average Chinese. Now I'm just a joke. get me that job, will you, by the way, back in the... So one of the key elements in increasing the buying power of Chinese has been the fact that they've had a real estate boom. Well, they had in the early 1990s, they really changed their real estate market. And the urban dwellers in China lived in these subsidized houses that they didn't own. Those subsidized houses belonged to their work unit. And in the 1990s, Premier Zhu Rongji and his team effectively privatized that market and allowed people to buy their apartments for very little money, as long as they agreed to stay in those apartments for a certain number of years. And so when that time limit was up, and a lot of people had access to one, two, or three, or four apartments, and when that time limit ended, these people then could sell their apartments. And so that created first a market in secondary housing, but then it also created a market in other housing projects. And this real estate boom has been going on for more than 20 some odd years. And so, like my classmates, I went to college in China in the 1980s. My classmates, when they graduated from college, they were making around 125 bucks US a month. Now, most of them make 15,000 US. A lot of them make up to 15,000 US a month, but their real money is in their house and in their houses. And you have housing prices in Beijing, which are they're higher than New York City. You know, the house we're looking at in Berkeley, in East Bay, is a hugely expensive area, is a lot lower than an equivalent house would be in Beijing or Shanghai. Because, you know, on the basis of this small, dingy apartment that you had, you could sell it after 6 or 7 years, make a bundle of cash, invest that in another apartment, resell that sucker, and you're talking real money. Then you're talking GW, not just for your kids, but for your grandkids and their grandkids. So it's been, and in addition, you have an economy that's been growing at double digits for 20 years. So, I mean, now they're the second biggest economy in the world, and they have a gap between rich and poor that's bigger than ours. And so their rich have a lot of money. And those people are generally the people you're seeing at GW and other places. Fred.
Some people, when they hear about your book, want to compare it to your views, to Kissinger's views in On China. Are you willing to compare positively and negatively?
I think that if there's a comparison, he likes to view China as a society that hasn't really been penetrated by many different ideas, and the Chinese are like this, and they will always be like this, and they were always like this before, and that's sort of Chinese culture, and it's sort of this impenetrable Great Wall, and how it deals with the rest of the world, and I think the Chinese are actually a lot more open, and have been deeply influenced by us, by the Europeans, by the Russians. And their worldview has been molded in that interaction. And so, if you read his book in the beginnings in the 19th century, there's a lot about how Western imperialists kind of humiliated China, but there's not that much about how Western imperialists also inspired China, specifically Americans, in terms of, I mean, the people who brought the idea to China that it should study Japan were not the Japanese, they were Yanks who ran newspapers in China writing in fluent classical Chinese. And that sort of warp and weave is something I think that he has a tendency not to emphasize because his argument is very culturalist. Like, you must understand the Chinese because they are different. And I think the Chinese are actually extremely open. And that comes from my perspective of actually having lived there. So.
So I have a question, but before the question, I'm a student at GW, I'm a Chinese student. GW is famous for its rich Korean kids because GW has two Korean presidents, but no Chinese president. and so my question is that recently I'm studying the topic about the Chineseness. So if you are a Han ethnic in China, you are counted as a Chinese or overseas. So can I say your book is about the interaction between the United States with the Han, the majority Han Chinese in China, excluding the Tibetan Uyghur and the Mongolians, and also talking about the loyalty of the overseas Chinese to the Chinese regime. Actually, the first president of the Republic of China has an American passport when he inaugurated. So I want to see your comments on the loyalty of the overseas Chinese. Thank you.
Great questions. So in the book, I spend most of my ink on the relationship between Americans and Han Chinese, but I also talk about the relationship between Americans and Tibetans because It started in the early 1900s. It continued and sort of flourished, if you will, in the 1950s when the CIA was trying to involve and encouraging Tibetan uprisings. And it's also continued to this day in Hollywood's continued obsession with all things Tibetan. So it's not just with the Han Chinese. In terms of the overseas Chinese, the gentleman was speaking about Sun Yat-sen. Sun Yat-sen was the first president of China. He began his revolutionary organization in Hawaii, the Revived China Society. And he did have an American passport that he needed because the Qing Dynasty officials were chasing him around the globe trying to arrest him. And he found that moving around the globe with an American passport was a lot more useful than moving around the globe with a Chinese passport. In terms of the loyalty of the overseas Chinese to China, I think that that's a fascinating story. There's a loyalty to China writ large, but what China has been an open question. So for many years, the Chinese American community was loyal to the government of Chiang Kai-shek and not to the communists. But over time, as we see today, the loyalty is much more, the pride is much more in the accomplishments of the regime on mainland China and not so much Taiwan. And now you see a growth of other communities like the Taiwanese who don't consider themselves Chinese and they want to have their own republic on the island of Taiwan. So like I said, it's a very complicated and entangled web we have here. So with that, thank you. Thank you very much.